Alrighty, welcome in. Chopadong here, going to go over the MLB chalkboard really quickly for DFSArmy.com, where you are a VIP member. It's a VIP tool only. You would come down to MLB section, slide over to the chalkboard, and what we're looking at default is the DraftKings chalkboard. There is a FanDuel tab right here. Very easy to click on and switch between the two. Just make sure you're on the correct site. Chalkboard is simply an ownership report. It's going to tell you position by position where all of the chalk is likely to fall today. Remember a couple of things though. Number one, bigger slates, ownership really gets spread around a lot and it becomes less important. And it's not non-existent in terms of importance, but it becomes less important. On smaller slates, three-game, four-game slates, it can be incredibly important. And a lot of leverage for tournaments can be generated by going away from the chalk and picking up an alternative player. So that would be kind of tip two in using these ownership reports is for your tournaments, where your single entry tournaments especially, where you're wanting to maybe take a suboptimal play, because if it's right, then the popular play is going to be wrong that night. And you're using the inherent variance or volatility of the sport of baseball to catapult yourself up the leaderboard. The object is to win the tournament. The object is not necessarily to post the highest score. And that sounds weird, but the optimal lineups, the optimal projections are going to produce chalky results because everybody sees the good quality plays. Everybody kind of conglomerates around those obvious plays, and those create kind of a school of fish or a herd of buffalo, however you want to picture it. And as successful as the night is, you know, that they're going to be successful or not depending on how those popular players do. And when they have really, really good nights, you're still in that giant herd of people fighting for that top prize. It leads to split top prizes and everything else. But you want to consider getting outside of that herd, that big glob of people, because when that glob fails, you have less resistance to the top of the leaderboard. And that's what creates the leverage that we talk about. And that's why ownership or fading the chalk becomes such a popular term or such a popular play, because it takes a suboptimal route to the top of the leaderboards. And in baseball, it's such a volatile sport that the chalk fails so often that it makes a ton of sense to go away from the high ownership players. That's what this chalkboard points out. Now you look at the starting pitcher on DraftKings and Zach Gallen and 29%, and Griffin Canning and Matthew Boyd all over 15% are probably going to be the higher owned pitchers. Now tonight you determine, do I want to take Zach Gallen? Do I agree with everybody? Where do I maybe want to get away from the ownership? Because if I take Zach Gallen with everybody else, what kind of salary does that free up for bats? And what bats are people most likely going to then gravitate towards? Will it be the Dodgers, or will it be, you know, somebody cheaper like a Miami Marlin type of player? Because that's what is everybody's going to have to kind of do the same things. So you can sort of predict their building tendencies and where their choices are going to, you know, to lie. And then you can either get away from it or join them. Sometimes you have options. An expensive stack. You find a cheap pitcher is going to be chalky. And I've got a Coors Field slate. It's very obvious that we're picking the Coors Field, you know, bats. And that's why we're picking a cheap pitcher. Well, maybe the Yankees are a very expensive set of bats that night too. And people will be going to Coors Field. So you can still take that cheap pitcher and then go for the Yankees. Okay, there's just different ways to think about this all the time. It's why the discussion inside the DFS Army is so important, to be able to ask these questions and bounce these ideas off of people's heads and get an idea as to if it's right or wrong, or if it's, you know, generating leverage in a tournament, or if it's just bat crap crazy or whatever. You want to kind of know where your thoughts are for the day in terms of what a lot of other people are thinking, because it helps you form your game plan. For cash games, however, you might want to pay more attention to that chalk and just eat it. Because in a 50-50 scenario, I might want all of the high-owned players on a slate. Because then, as they rise and fall, so do I. And if they all have a good night, so do I. If they all have a bad night, so do I. But I still have other options in my lineup that can get me. If 50% of the field is sunk and I'm in that 50%, or let's say 40%, 40% of that field is sunk in a 50-50 contest, there's still 10% or so of that field that has a fighting chance at making it into the money. Okay? So, and then, well, I guess it's actually 60% fails, then 10% can still make the money. So I had it a little bit reversed, but I hope you understand the point, which is there's safety in that chalk in these cash games. Tonight may not be the best example because we've got a lot of spread out ownership. You don't see any 30 and 40% type guys on these sheets, especially down here at shortstop. You see a lot of balance. So cash games, this tool is not maybe as useful as it would be on a shorter slate, a 4 or a 5 game slate, where you can identify those very, very core plays. Like I would say, Travis d'Arnaud, Zach Gallen would be considered for cash games very heavily. And the other guys are all, kind of wide open. You're not getting much of a distinct advantage by taking these guys in a cash game for any kind of safety net. You are seeing how ownership gets spread out in tournaments on large slates because now what you're seeing is I can take any of these guys and I can even take the heaviest owned guy and I really, it's not that popular. It's not so dominant that I, can really have to consider just getting away from him. The same over on FanDuel. Pitchers a lot of times concentrate a little bit more there because they only take one pitcher. But the similar situation is showing up where we've got a lot of balance. We've got some popular players, but there's a whole bunch of relatively popular players at each position, which means cash games are going to be pretty wide open tonight. And your tournament's ownership is not going to be as important. There's not the heavy consideration that needs to be taken for fading the chalk tonight because the slate is so large that ownership is naturally just going to kind of filter out and spread out regardless. Come back and look at this tool on a shorter slate of, 3 games or 4 games, and notice how it changes. You will see very dominant players at each position, and that will give you a much better sense in a tournament of do I want to use that guy or not, or in cash games, do I want to use that guy or not. Hopefully that explanation helps guiding you through the tool a little bit. Very simplistic tool in that we just look at the ownership percentage and we're trying to figure out where everybody else is going to be using these players, and then we can make our own judgment for a cash game or for a tournament, whether we want to ride inside the herd or in a tournament, maybe get outside the herd a little bit. Okay, take care and keep asking those questions.